What if we were right on the edge of seeing the greatest global harvest in history? We all, I think, have seen, even just over the last couple of years, how global the world has actually become and is becoming. What if the harvest did that? I really feel like in this season, the Lord is saying the harvest is coming. There is a harvest of people that are going to be coming into the kingdom. They're coming. It's ready. And I'm actually just going to start with actually the words of Jesus from Matthew 9, 37. Probably heard this verse a million times, maybe in your life. But Jesus said 2,000 years ago, the harvest truly is plentiful. Or, right, harvest is plentiful. That means there's a lot of it. The harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, or so, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Those are the words of Jesus. The harvest is plentiful. There's a lot of it. It's not too dark. It's not too broken. There's a lot of it. It's like when you go out and pick berries and you find the perfect patch. You're like, I don't want to tell anybody about this patch because there's so many, and I'm going to cash in on all of these blueberries. Jesus is like, there's so many blueberries out there. So, as Pastor Mike said, my name's Christy. I grew up in this church. For those of you who don't know me, my family moved here when I was 10. This church raised me. I had the Hobbs, Patty, Chris, and Lloyd way back having me over to their house for youth group, leading my youth group. I love this church. I have been living in Berlin for the last just over five years. I moved there with YWAM. The original purpose of the team that I was sent there with was to share the gospel with refugees that were coming in from the Middle East when Europe several years ago had the refugee crisis flood into Europe. And so that was the original purpose of why we moved there. Over time, we kind of boiled our team into three kind of main purposes. One was worship and prayer. We have had a strong sense of nothing really happens without prayer, the presence of God, and worshiping Jesus. That is what we are called to do as believers. That is our mandate, to spend time in the presence of God and to cry out, God, would you send? Would you bring salvation? Would you change the city? Would you, all the things that we want God to do. Second one was evangelism. Going out, we'd go out on the streets and just walk streets and go up and talk to people. Hopefully building relationships with people. And the third was training and training young people, young adults into missions. So over the last couple of years, we have taken young adults on short mission trips, namely into the Middle East and Africa, but mostly to the Middle East. So those are the kind of three things: prayer and worship, local evangelism, and training and sending of missionaries. There's something very powerful about somebody going to do missions, even for just 2 weeks. It changes your worldview. It shows you the power of what is possible with God. God loves all of the nations. Just like that verse shares, go into all of the world. Like, God is doing things in the Middle East, in Africa, in Europe, in America, in Nome. God's doing things. So I am just going to share some stories, because I love stories, and everybody loves stories, of just some of the things that have gone on the last few years. I would say, for me personally, one of the biggest things that happened to me when I moved to Germany was I got the gift of encountering people from the Middle East. Berlin is very international. You can get on a train and nobody will be speaking German. You'll hear Arabic, Portuguese, Russian. Everyone's there. So you'll meet someone, I'm from Israel, I'm from Brazil, I'm from Iran, I'm from Syria, I'm from Iraq, I'm from Rome, I'm wherever. And then sometimes you meet, I was born in Berlin, you're like, oh, you're Vader. One of the girls, I met a young woman from, she's Syrian, but she grew up in Saudi Arabia. And through a friend, I met her at an event. And I am a writer, I write, and she was a writer. And so we connected. I was like, hey, we should get coffee, you know, let's meet up. So we met up, and I tried to share Jesus with her. I was talking about Jesus, and it was like all of these arguments came up. You know, it was like talking to a wall. The more you try to share Jesus, the more you hit a wall, you know. I don't know if you've ever encountered that. Just like the person is not available, you know, for this conversation, or you're just not getting anywhere, you know. So I was like, well, can I pray for you? Like, the time's coming to an end, you know. She's like, yeah, so I pray for her. I don't remember what I prayed. We get up to leave, you know, and she said something after that was just like, wow, that prayer, I just feel so much better, or whatever. She encountered God as I was praying, and that was like the biggest thing of anything I said. Nothing I said really worked, and I prayed for her, and something happened. I was like, well, that's great. So then a long time goes by, and I don't see her for months. Sometimes you message people, and they never respond. You're like, okay, whatever. So finally, I meet up with her again, and she's not doing well. You can see she has just darkness over her, heaviness, just struggling. I still, to this day, do not know all of her story. She, when she came to Berlin, had gotten connected, unfortunately, with somebody in the occult. She even shared with me, you know, I have had a voice speaking out of me saying, you know, you're just like, okay. So I'm talking with her, and she's just struggling. And so I was like, well, prayer worked the last time. Let's try that again, you know. So, and I come to find out she can't sit or stand for very long because she has really bad back pain. So she can only sit for a certain period of time, and then she has to move. And I was like, well, can I just pray for your back to be healed? Can I pray over you? And so she's like, yeah. So I pray over her, and she's like, thank, and something shifted to where I left this conversation, and I was like, I think she just got delivered from demonic oppression. Like, something was over her, and I was like, wow, she got delivered. And so we start walking, and she's like, actually, my back is a lot better. I was like, well, praise God, you know. So I came away, I was like, wow, that was amazing. Like, I prayed for her, and obviously stuff just kind of lifted off of her. She probably got partially healed, fully healed, something happened. So then months go by. I don't see her. I don't know what's happening to her. Probably like half a year later, I finally connect with her. We meet up, and I see her, and she looks like a different person. I'm like, she looks like she got saved. You know, like, her face is completely different. I'm like, something has happened to her. I don't know what happened, but, you know. And I'm like, how are you doing? She's like, oh, yeah, I'm doing so much better. I have a job now, da, 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 da. So we, you know, are talking, and she's like, I actually wanted to ask you. She's like, I have demons, or she's like, I have spirits in my house, and I don't know what to do about it. And this girl is fully tapped into the spiritual realm. She knows there's evil spirits. She's very aware of all of that realm. It's like, she understands it. People kind of think she's probably crazy, but she knows it's real. And so she's just fully lost, doesn't know Jesus. And so she's like, how do we, you know, she's wanting to know, how do we get rid of these? And I'm like, okay, like, in my mind, I'm like, you need to follow Jesus, you need to get saved, because we don't have any authority over the demonic without the presence of God. Like, the Jesus living in us,
amen,
is the power over that.
Amen.
And there's even the verse where it says, you can send out a spirit, and it'll look and roam, and then it'll come back, and the house is clean, and it comes and brings more, worse than before. And so I'm trying to explain the concept to her. You need to, like, fill this place with something. And so I start sharing Jesus with her again. I hit a wall. She is just not... There's so much baggage connected to Jesus with her. All of these ideologies, probably coming from a Muslim background, probably maybe pain in her life. There's obviously stuff with witchcraft that has been going on. And so I'm like, okay, I am just, it is not working, you know. So she gets up, she's not getting it. She's not understanding Jesus. Jesus doesn't really make sense to her. So she gets up and goes goes to do something, and I just pray. I'm like, God, I don't know what to do. I felt like I was punching a stone wall, you know. I was like, I don't know what to do. What do I even say? You know, would you just help me, God? I don't know what to do. And she comes back, and the Holy Spirit helped me. Somehow I switched my language, and I started talking about the Holy Spirit. And it was like the gates just opened fully wide. You can run for miles. She completely understood. I was like, Jesus doesn't make sense, but the Holy Spirit makes 100% sense. She understands spirits. So my language of using the Holy Spirit made so much sense to her. And I was like, my theology got a little bit rocked. I was like, can we even do this? Like, is this? And so I started sharing. I'm like, you can invite. The Holy Spirit lives inside of us. He lives inside of me. And you want to fill this space with the Holy Spirit, because he's the only one that has authority over this.
That's right.
Because if you use other stuff and you tell them to leave, it'll be worse. And she's like, yeah, that's what happened. I did everything I needed to do, and now it's worse than it was. And I was like, yes, this is what you need, the Holy Spirit. He's the only one that has power over this. And I pretty much asked her, I'm like, do you want to invite the Holy Spirit into your life? And I'm like, can we even do this? I feel like I'm sharing the gospel backwards, you know? But I was like, this is the only thing that's working. I'm just going to go as far as I can, you know? And I had peace of mind in the sense that I know, like, the Holy Spirit's number one job is to reveal Jesus.
Yes.
And I knew, I was like, I can't get her to Jesus. I don't know how to get there. But if I can get her to the Holy Spirit, mm-hmm. the Holy Spirit is mm-hmm. going to get her to Jesus.
Come on.
He will reveal Jesus better than I can, and he will help her. And I was like, okay, we're just going to go with this, you know? And so I was like, do you want to invite the Holy Spirit into your life? And she says, yes. And I'm like, okay, like, we'll pray. And I'm like, you can, like, repeat after me. And I'm like, I hope I'm not putting heresy right now. And so I was like, all right. And I just prayed a prayer, like, Holy Spirit, come into my life. And prayed with her. She prayed it. And I was like, okay, what happened? She's like, I felt like I wasn't alone. And then she says, I felt darkness going down into the ground. And I was like, well, that's good. You know, so that's always a good sign. You know? So, after that conversation, I was like, okay, go home, invite the Holy Spirit to come into your house, give her some worship music, play this, you know, tell me what happens. Never heard from her. Messaged her later, I was like, hey, how's it going? She's like, yeah, it's been better. And I have not seen her since that day. I only got to meet with her. At one point, in one of the times I met with her, I actually gave her a Bible in Arabic. I was like, I want to give you this is your mother tongue. I want to give you this in this language. And she's like, my sister's a Christian. And I was like, well, that's interesting. And so I do not know what happened to her. But it was this beautiful experience for me, because it was someone that I only could talk to them about every 6 months or a year. I had no, and she just would not connect back with me. But every time I connected with her, she encountered a little bit more of God, a little bit more of God, a little bit more of God. And I was like, wow, God is actually working in her life. He's the common thread here. It's not me. Because I only see her once a year, twice a year. But every time, it was very intentional. God was doing something in her life. And I'm like, even though I may never see her again, maybe I will, maybe I won't, God is bringing her to himself, and she's on the journey of finding him. And I was so encouraged. I was like, God doesn't need me. He uses me. But even if I'm not there, I can't be there. God is actually doing something with her. He's the common thread, not me.
Amen.
And I get to be a part of it. I was like, this is so cool.
Amen.
And so that was just a beautiful experience of getting to see God do that. The girl that actually connected me with her is a very fun story as well. So we were doing, just going out on the streets this one day and looking for people to talk to. And, you know, for me, the confession, I'm supposed to be a missionary. I actually sometimes really struggle with talking to people. There's moments when God's like, you should maybe go talk, go in there. And I'm like, yeah, that's probably not God. You know, like, why? Because I'm actually afraid. I actually don't want to have a conversation. I'm actually afraid to you're like, that's probably not the Lord. Go in there and maybe look for someone to share the gospel with. That's not God. That's probably God. There's been moments I've disobeyed because I was afraid, because I didn't want to, you know. So this time, we are walking, I have this slight impression, this feeling, we should go into this cafe, and I hesitate because I'm confronted with that. If we go in there, you're going to talk to someone, and then we are, oh, it's hard, you know. And so I hesitated. My friend, this is always why it's a good damn friend, she's like, should we go in there? And I was like, yeah, we should go in there. You know, she felt to go in there as well. So we go in, we get to talk to this girl. So significant. She's like, my name means light in the darkness. You're like, okay. She is from Turkey, but she grew up Muslim, is not interested in Islam, kind of more interested in New Age, really. But she'll tell me, she's totally tapped in with God. She'll be like, God told me this. And I'll be like, that actually sounds like God. That sounds, I know God's voice, that sounds like something he would actually say. So we became friends. We would meet up, share Jesus with her. We're like, we love Jesus. She was connected to us. We became friends. I've known her for the last couple of years, 2 or 3 years. And we'd share Jesus with her. And it came to this one day where we were going to have breakfast. And I was just like, God, I don't want to just have a good breakfast to say we did. I don't know what to do. I feel like I've shared Jesus. I don't know what to do. I don't know where to go from here. I don't know what to say. And I felt like God spoke to me. And he said, I gave her a dream of me. And I was like, okay, well, find out if that's really God or not, because it could be the pizza I had for lunch, you know, me, who knows. So I go to meet with her, and I ask her, I'm like, hey, have you ever had any dreams of a man in white or Jesus or anything, you know? And she's like, yeah, actually. She's like, I had this recurring dream several times. There's this shepherd, and he's always very far away from. And it was like there, I guess he was trying to get to her, but there was always this big distance. And she was like, I just decided I was going to quit having this dream because I kept having it. And it bothered her that she didn't know who the shepherd was, or he was sad, or she didn't know who he was, or there was like a distance or something about the dream. She didn't like it. And so she quit dreaming it. And I was like, she's literally dreaming the gospel, you know. The shepherd going after the sheep, you know? And I was like, I told her, I'm like, I know what that dream means. And she looks at me with these big eyes, kind of like, how do you know that, you know? And I go into her and I explain, like, here, Jesus calls himself the good shepherd. And I gave her the scripture passages from, you know, Jesus going after the lost sheep, Jesus from John 10, I am the good shepherd, you know? And it was just this beautiful moment of seeing at the point where I was like, like, I don't even know what to say. Like, nothing is really working. I'm like, I don't know what to do. And it was like God gave me a little key. He's like, here's a key. And I found God was there. And here was the key to open up more of explaining who Jesus was. So time goes by. Up until last December, my friend and I are meeting with her. And both of us knew her, both of us had a relationship with her and this other friend. And we kind of felt, my friend was like, I feel like they're coming to a point of decision. They're going to have to make a decision. And so, you know, especially the other girl, not this particular girl, but the other girl. So it was crazy. They were, both front girls were supposed to come. The one that I'm sharing about came, the other one came late. She got the time wrong, which was totally a God thing. Because me and my friend start talking to this girl that had the dream. And we're just talking about God. I don't even remember what we're talking about Jesus, something. And she just, neither of us expected this. She's like, do you think I should? And she's genuinely asking. Like, she's like, do you think I should become a Christian? And both of us are just, like, floored. Like, neither of us were expecting that. We were just like, what? Also, we're just kind of, like, in our minds, like, this is what we've been trying to, like, bring you to this whole 2 years. But, like, great that you never assumed we were pushing, I guess, you know? But, like, and we're just kind of like, yeah, you should, you know. And the presence of God showed up in the room. All three of us felt it. She felt it. She's also tapped into like feeling, encountering the spiritual realm. She knew something was happening. And it was like she came to this point.
Praise God.
And she's like, I want to think about it. And we're like, okay, yeah, this is an important decision. Like this, you know, I'm wanting to be clear, this is going to cost you something. Especially for Muslims, it does cost something. And so the other friend finally comes late, and the whole camp, the presence of God lifts. It's like it's over. So then, and this is after this, she decides, she's like, I'm not going to become a Christian. And we were so disappointed. We were just like, are you serious? Like, you came to this point, and then he said no. And I met with her actually right before I came here. And I have plans to meet with her when I go back. And I am still, the story is not done with her. I still believe, I'm like, she has to get saved. She is like such a significant person. She was one of the few people I've met, I'm like, that when I met her, I was like, you are so significant, you're supposed to be a believer. And even though that moment, I share that with you to show you just the progression of the story in her life. Even though people have the choice, that I can't force her to follow Jesus. She has to choose that. She has to want that. And I know God has been faithful to her whole life. God gave her dreams long before she ever met me. God put me in her life. God is probably going to put other Christians in her life. The story is not over with her yet. Just because he said no this time doesn't mean it's not done. You know, and so I'm still believing for her to actually get saved. I love her. If you think about her, even though you don't know her name, just be like, hey, that girl that Christy was talking about, God's just save her. I believe he's going to. But it's really fun when they actually do say yes. So this one day, again, going out to do, we did like evangelism weekly, just every Wednesday. Some days we would go out and walk and not talk to anybody. Like, well, that felt kind of like a failed time, but you know, we're here. And so many of those times, it's not all glory stories, but there are those stories. You don't get them unless you're doing it. Sometimes it's just like, well, I tried to talk to people and they didn't listen. Well, I prayed today. And so many like times, we would walk and pray on the streets, and the Lord would encourage me a couple of times. He's like, you have no idea how significant it is that you're just here. And I was like, okay, you know, but this one day, so we go to a park, and my friend and I, it was just us, we sat down, and I had a drink, and we were just sitting there, and neither of us we didn't feel like we wanted to give in to the pressure of like, okay, let's just try to force ourselves to talk to somebody, just all of the pressure that you feel of that. And so we just sat there for a while, and there was this, we were sitting in front of a children's play area, there was this young girl in her 20s, maybe, and these kids, and they're just playing. We're just sitting, talking, watching them. And just kind of me, partly being like afraid, partly not wanting to just give in to pressure of trying to force something to happen, but largely also too, I still, like so many times, almost every time, that fear comes up in me of like, oh, we're gonna talk to them, and I have to face fear almost every single time. And I share that because it's real. Like, I'm not a superhuman, even as a missionary. Like, I'm supposed to do this for a living, and I still am like, oh, God, help me. You know, like, I'm an introvert. I don't like talking to people on planes. And I'm just like, we gotta go talk to someone we don't know. It's like, okay, we can do this, you know. And I'm sitting there and just kind of watching. Didn't feel any pressure to go do it, but I see where this girl, they're getting up ready to leave, and this thought goes through my mind that says, now's your chance. The thing you kind of don't want to hear, because then you actually have to like face like, oh no, we have to do it, you know. And so I'm wrestling, like all of a sudden I enter this wrestle of like, okay, just we can do this, you know, but we don't really want to do it, but we can do it, you know. And I love sharing Jesus with people. Once I'm in it, I love it. It's just the working up the courage to go do it is the hard part. And so I'm wrestling, and I also know it's a time bomb. They're gonna leave, and I'm gonna miss a window if I don't act. And so I'm like, okay, like, and then the glorious thought entered my mind, which was probably from the Lord. I could give them my empty bottle I had been drinking. was they were Roma people. And that people group is actually very looked down on in Europe. They are often begging for money. They go around begging and asking for bottles because they can get money back. They were also killed by the Nazis in the war. Not as many people know about that as the Jews, but and they're still kind of looked down on in Europe. And so they were Roma. And so I'm like, I can go get for my bottle, and that will actually like be something not weird that I can start a conversation. And so I'm like, okay. So I go up and I was like, it's worth 17 cents to like talk to someone, you know? So I go up and I get the bottle and I start talking to her. I'm trying to bring up Jesus, you know, hey, like I follow Jesus, da 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 da. And we're talking, I'm trying to share the gospel with her, share Jesus with her. She's like, I don't believe Jesus is the Son, is God. And I was like, okay. And so we're talking, and somehow the Lord, I felt, led me to start talking about hearing God's voice. And I was like, I hear God's voice. I told her the story. This one day I lost my slippers. I didn't know where they were. I looked for weeks, couldn't find them. And out of more exasperation than anything, I was like, God, where are my slippers? And this thought went through my mind that said they're in the closet. I was like, oh, I haven't been to the closet. So I go and look in there. And so I tell her this story, and she is glued to me. She's just like eating every word. She's hanging on every word I'm saying. This kid that's with her, beside her, is like pulling on her, like, hey, let's go, we need to go. And she's not even looking at them. She's just pushing them away. She's like, I want to hear everything you're saying. And so I am talking to her, and I found this out afterwards. My friend who's with me is praying about, and she's distance away, kind of distracting the children, praying them about even on this topic of the voice of God, which is what was the key to like her engaging with me. So I shared the gospel with her. I shared everything I know to say, and I got to the point where I was like, I don't know what else to say. Like, I've said everything. And she's still just like hanging on me. And so I'm like, do you want to give your life to Jesus? And she's like, yes. And I was like, okay. And so I was like, we can pray, and you pray after me, and she prayed, and afterwards I was like, what do you feel? What happened? She's like, I feel joy. And which is like, when I hear that, I'm like, yeah, something is real, you know? And the kid, it's interesting, the kid that was sitting next to her, that was pulling on her this whole time, is now looking at her with this like seriousness of the kid knew something important was happening. The kid is looking at her just kind of with this face of something important is going on right now. And she turns to this kid and she says, God is real. And then she asks me, she's like, so do you do magic? You know, because here she's invited God into her life and she's encountering salvation. She's encountering God. So she's thinking, I'm like working magic, you know? And I'm like, no, like I'm not, you know, and you... But when you hear that, you're like, oh yeah, something happened. That's real. And I left, and I was so encouraged. I was like, yes. That person was one conversation away from finding Jesus. It took me like work getting over my fear of getting up there. And I'm like, man, I would have missed out on that. She would have missed out. We all would have missed out. And I'm like, how does somebody go from not believing Jesus is God to praying, Jesus, you're God, and I invite you into my life and getting saved? God. Mm-hmm. God? Like, that's not me. Like, I don't have that much control over people. You know, you can't control it. But some God wants people to get saved more than any of us want that.
It's true.
And he just is looking for people who are willing to say yes. Yeah. God, I don't even know what I'm doing. Like, so many times, it's like, God, help. What do I even say? There might be people in your life, you're like, I know this person doesn't know God, but I don't even know what to say. Ask God. God knows what to say. Like, so many times, God brings me to things, and I'm like, well, it's actually, that. I look back, and I'm like, that was the Lord leading me, because he knows what they need to hear. Stories of discipleship. Like I said, we've taken teams largely, I haven't been to the Middle East, but my friends have. I led a team to Africa. a year, a little over a year now, which was so fun. We took four German young women to Tanzania. Some of them had like never really shared their testimony, weren't comfortable sharing the gospel. And so I was like, okay, here's how you share your testimony, here's how you share the gospel. Took them out, did evangelism. They wanted to do, should go out and do evangelism again. I was like, these girls are amazing. They're like, can we do more evangelism? A couple of them went out, came back, and like three or four women got saved. And we were like, yes, you know? And it was so fun to watch them in the end, one of those girls sharing, standing before about 30 young Tanzanian guys, sharing her testimony, sharing about the struggle she had with her father, preached the gospel, invited them to get saved. About, you know, 20 guys raised their hands. And that was just so fun to watch young women go from the place of, I've never really done this before, I don't really know how, I don't really feel comfortable, to like full on just sharing their testimony, preaching the gospel, and inviting people to get saved. People raising their hands, you know? And so, and that's just such a powerful thing. It's the power of discipleship. If the harvest really is as big and as ripe as the Bible says it is, and that Jesus has run out of people, then we need to train more people, because we need more help. Like, there's people out there one conversation away. There's people out there that we are the crux of them getting wrecked by God. It's just one conversation. One conversation with you, you with your coworkers on the night shift, sitting there when everything's dead at 2 a.m, one conversation from you completely messing up someone's life in a good way with God. And God wants to do that. God wants to do that in this city. Mm-hmm. There's people at Nome Belts I will never reach. There's people at Norton Sound that I will never reach. There's people in the villages on the coast that I will never reach. There's people at your work, at the mechanic shop, that I will never reach. There's people, and Pastor Mike won't reach them either. It's all of us. And as I was praying about this morning, I felt like the Lord said, he said, I've given them a message. And I felt, and I just want to encourage you with that. God gave you, he's already given it to you.
Yes.
We already have the gospel. That's all Christians. We have the greatest story, the best news that people are actually dying to hear. And sometimes we actually don't even give people the honor and the dignity to have a choice to refuse it, because we're so afraid. Oh, they probably don't want to hear it. They're just going to blow it off. Oh, and we don't even give them a chance to blow it off, because we're so afraid to actually share it. Me included. Like, me, I'm speaking to the choir here. But there are people that are dying to hear this. And nobody can tell your story for you. Your message is your story. What did God do for you? Like, what is your story? What did God do in your life that changed your life?
Yes.
Someone needs to hear that. Because there's someone out there that wants your story. I don't have your story. I'm not tapping the people that you're out picking berries with, the people that you're hunting with, the people that, all of those people that are out in the villages, that are in this city, that's you guys. You guys have the honor of reaching those people. And I would challenge you, what is holding you back from that? Do your coworkers know that you love Jesus? Does your neighbor know that you're a Christian? Have you ever told them? Have you ever asked them? You know, like, sometimes we zip our mouths shut. If you want to imagine, there's a big zipper here over your mouth, and we let it be zipped shut because of all of the things that get spoken to us in our mind. Well, you don't actually have time right now to talk about God. You've got a meeting in 30 minutes. Well, they don't want to hear it. Well, you're going to lose your job. Well, they're going to think you are just weird. They're going to think you're judgmental. All of those things. Well, you're not going to know what to say when they have questions. Well, they're going to ask all this stuff you don't know how to answer. Well, all of this stuff that comes up, and we just end up being silent. We end up not saying anything sometimes. Like, well, it's too scary, you know? Like, I just don't know how. You know, like, I don't even know what to say. I don't know. You know, maybe there's people like Pastor Mike or, you know, Christy or whoever that's like, they know how to do that, and from someone who had been there, left, came back on a short trip, and they're like, it's different. People will talk to us now. And I was like, that's so encouraging to hear, someone who lives here. And so hard things actually make people more open, often. And the world has gone through a tough couple of years. Don't waste that opportunity. Like, don't waste it. Like, God help me not to waste it. And what is it? If this resonates with you at all, I would just challenge you, ask the Lord, God, are there any zippers on my mouth right now? Like, is there anything that is hindering me from having that conversation? Hey, can I just pray for you? Hey, that happened to me once. I went through depression. Can I pray? God, Jesus changed me. He gave me joy. Can I pray for you? Hey, I follow Jesus. Are you an atheist? What do you think about God? Like, open up those conversations. Like, what's the worst that happens? You're not going to ruin it. You know, like, sometimes I think maybe have a little bit of the fear of, like, I'm going to break and ruin it. No. God loves them too much, you know. And I love this church. These stories are your fruit. This church, you guys raised me. The people that I know here, you raised me. You were Jesus to me for years. And then you sent me out with your prayers, with your support, as wind in my sails. These people that you've never met, they're what you are a part of. It's your reward. That girl in the park that you'll never meet, that's your reward. All of the things that none of us know of what happened in Berlin the last 5 years, because they were prayers that I never saw answered, it's your reward. Thank you so much for being that for me, for being that I can move to the other side of the planet with my church saying, we are so for you, we believe in you. That means so much to me. I just want to say thank you. And I honor you as the stewards and the guards of this city. And what if the biggest harvest was right around the corner? And what if that came to them? There's enough people in this room to turn the city upside down.
Amen. Help us, Jesus.
This is enough. Because God is God.
That's right.
What if people you've never seen in church actually just started weeping out on the street because the presence of God was so tangible in this city? But they're just like, I don't even know what's happening. I need to get right with God.
That would be so awesome.
That could happen. Yes. Like, what if there was a gnome that no one had ever seen before because something came to this city that has never happened before? Wouldn't that be awesome? I want that for this city. I want that for White Mountain and Elam and all of the villages. Like, God can do that.
Amen. Yes.
And like, what is your part of that? And how can you do that? It's actually fun. Talking about Jesus is actually so one of the best things. I get joy from it. You get the love of God from it. Because God's like, oh, look, they want to share me with them. That person that doesn't know me, give my child love to give to them. And you're just like, God, love you. I don't know how to say this anymore. Because God starts pointing his love on you to give to them.
Yes.
You get to be the channel. You get to cash in on all of that.
Yes.
And that is amazing. And I honor you for all of the places that you're doing that. Like, you are the hands and feet of the city. You're Jesus' hands and feet of the city. And when God has entrusted you with people's lives that he is not entrusting you with. And that is so beautiful. And it's such a gift. We get to be Jesus to people. And we get to be the people that, like, see someone encounter God maybe for the first time. How amazing is that? And, like, all of us sometimes need to ask God, help me to unzip my mouth. It's time to actually start speaking out more about this. This period of history, God wants to do something in the earth to bring people to him.
Mm-hmm.
And it's time for us to actually run even harder than we've already been running. Not that we haven't been doing it, but let's push more. Let's ask, let's do more. Let's be like, okay, God, what's the more that you want? How can I be a part of that? How can I tap that person that thinks everybody thinks will never get saved? Let me take them on. Let me, like, love them into the kingdom. Love them so hard they can't help but find Jesus, you know? So training of young adults into missions. So that is going to be a little bit more my thing of doing probably more training, probably on evangelism, because I actually love that. And I love training. It's still not all of the details are not all nailed down, but that is coming down the pipe. I really do feel still called to be in Europe. I really feel like God is sending me up to be in Europe for the long game. And I'm totally happy with that. I'd be happy to stay there for years. And so I would love prayer for that, just this transition of moving to another country, and like just change is hard, and but I'm excited. I believe God has like new things in store for Europe. God wants to like break in to Europe. It is an amazing time to actually be alive. Like, it is. Like, even though there are so many hard things, like those hard things God wants to take and use to actually wake people up. And that's exciting, and we get to be a part of that. So thank you so much for praying for me, for supporting me. If you don't know me and want to hang out, find me. I love friends. If you actually have any questions of missions, find me. Love to help in any way I can. Or if you're just like, hey, I just want to please pray for me. I'd love to pray for you. Any way that I can bless you will be a blessing. I will be here till Thursday. So, come talk to me. Come find me. Would love to bless you and encourage you in any way that I can while I'm here. So thank you.
Thank you, Christy. I'm going to pray for Christy and invite you to extend a hand that you would join in our prayers. And just to let you know, if you want to give to a special gift for Christy, you can use our offering box or the kiosk and just designate it on your check or with the envelopes out there that it's for Christy, and we'll give a special gift for her for her ministry, especially in making a move. Okay, so let's pray for her. Father God, we thank you for this servant who's heard your call to serve, to share the good news, to do it even in a place that is far away from family and home. And that she continues to hear that call and get set to make a move to a new place to continue to serve you. Father, provide what she needs for making that change, for the transition. Continue to stir her heart to be concerned and to love and want to reach out to those who don't know you. Give her wisdom and encouraging and training other servants who are there to do your work. And Father, as she goes about these couple days left here in Nome and then travels more, Father, just keep her safe. Allow her to be able to take that good news that she's experienced and to bring it to those who might experience it too. Give her that hope of one day being able to gather around your throne and being able to see faces there that she recognizes of those who are there because of your touch through her life. Bless her, Father. Encourage her and strengthen her and pour out your Spirit upon her. We pray in Christ's name. Over the last 7-8 weeks, we've been looking at some messages that Jesus gave to his churches in Revelation 2 and 3, 7 letters. And part of the assignment that you were given last week was to write that letter from Jesus to our church. And some of you may have already done that. I know I've gotten a couple by email. I haven't opened those, so I haven't read them to see exactly what they say. And perhaps some of you have a paper form ready this morning. If not, there's still the form out on the table anyway. And so I just want to encourage you to somehow get it to me so that tomorrow morning I can begin that process of looking through them and hearing the voice of Jesus as he's been speaking through you and putting them together to create one letter to bring to you next Sunday. So if you have one here this morning, be sure to get it to me before you leave. If you want to email it to me, newso@gnomecovenant@gmail.com, and we'll put those together so we can hear. Because just as Christy shared her stories, Jesus has a story for us to do and to live out as a church. And that's what we're desiring to find out. Trying to live out the story of Jesus. The story that began so long ago. The story that we get to sing about in this Christmas season. And so I'm going to invite the worship team to come back, and they're going to come and lead us in that new Christmas song that, you know, will describe to us about how the praise goes on because of all that has happened in this Christmas season in the coming of our Savior. Let's stand together.
David starts out so many of those psalms just in anguish. By the time the psalm is over, it's praise. And that praise goes on for eternity. And we get to be a part of that. And part of Advent is looking ahead to the birth of Christ 2,000 years ago. But part of Advent is looking forward to his return in the future. And so this psalm kind of speaks to both of that. It's looking to that first coming back in the manger, but it's also looking to the praise that goes on and on and on and on and on forever in eternity.
Amen.
That time when Christ will return.
Amen.
And so I don't know about, I hope that this is one of those songs that just kind of resonates throughout the season. Ever since we started working on this, it has been coming back up in my mind, and it's a good one to have there. So here we go. Hope you remember it.
given us to be part of the sharing of this good news of Jesus, to be part of those who are spreading the praise that will go on for eternity. As we go into this week, as Advent begins, as we move towards Christmas, let us always be